Facebook needs to be regulated. Yes, errors do occur. They always do. And yes, you are right to say we have a very heavy obligation to constantly do better and to learn from those mistakes. I both understand, anticipate why people should be concerned that, you know, too much power and authority falls into the hands of one company.
Your boss, Mark Zuckerberg, appealed recently to governments to regulate big tech. To what extent does Facebook want to have a say in these new rules?
Well, we don't decide the rules. That's, you know, particularly in the democratic world, in North America and Europe, that is for democratic politicians. So we can't write the rules. That's for politicians to decide. But quite a lot of these rules are technically difficult and they're complicated. How do you diminish hate speech? How do you protect elections? How do you stop foreign interference? How do you ensure that people have a healthy, safe and wholesome experience on our platforms, not a dangerous or unpleasant one? On all of these things, we think we have learnt a lot, not only from what we've successfully done, but also the mistakes that have been made, and we want to share that with governments.
I'm asking this because critics are claiming that the lobby of Facebook, the current lobby of Facebook, is meant to, let's say, minimize the harmful effects of new regulation.
Look, I think at the moment anything that Facebook says is treated cynically. So, you know, in the past people said Facebook needs to be regulated. So now Facebook says we need to be regulated, and people say, why are they saying that they want to be regulated? Look, there's a saying in English, the proof will be in the eating of the pudding. Let us see what we can do together.
You used to be a prominent critic of Facebook. Why join such a company?
I don't think technology is good or bad. It's what we make of it. And that's the big wider social debate. And I, in my new role in Facebook, hope that Facebook can play a responsible and mature role in making a contribution to that debate. And I would like us to move beyond just shouting at tech and trying to fix tech.
Have you been able to make fundamental changes within Facebook yourself last year?
Well, I think the shift that we're talking about now is a shift that I have been intimately involved with, which is to turn a page on the period of time during which Silicon Valley companies traditionally and conventionally rejected any idea of new rules and regulation for the internet, to something completely different, which is where we are now a leader in Silicon Valley in saying, look, of course society expects that there should be rules and regulations for this industry, just as much as society expects that there should be rules and regulations for other parts of the economy as well. So that is a big change, and it's a change which I'm intimately involved with. And one of my roles in Facebook is to oversee and lead the policies of the company, from data protection to anti-terrorism, from online political advertisements to privacy principles. And there's a lot of work to be done there.
Let's talk about the proof and the punning. Because running up to the EU elections, Facebook promised in Parliament in the Netherlands that it would not be possible anymore to place political ads in other countries. An NGO called Bits of Freedom proved that it can still easily be done. How is this still possible?
The advertisement, which I think that NGO used, Bits of Freedom, was a photo without text, and our systems, we've been very open about that, our systems, because most political advertisements, the vast majority of political advertisements, of course, have text. Vote for this party, vote for that party, here's our manifesto. So our systems didn't pick it up. The scale of what we're dealing with is huge. We never pretend that we're going to find every single offending bit of content, particularly if it is not camouflage, but if it's designed in a way which is difficult for our systems to pick up. So we have to rely on people reporting to us as well. Look, all rules are rules which people can either choose to respect or not.
About the live stream function of Facebook after the Christchurch attack, Facebook adjusted the live stream function in a very minimal way. Only people who are flagged previously will be banned from the live stream function. Why not take it down fully?
Now, during the time which he live streamed his barbaric murderous act in those two mosques in Christchurch, 200 people saw it. There were 4,000 views before we took it down. We took it down some minutes after we were notified and after his attack.
But it spread everywhere.
We are now seeking to establish a much, much more effective operations center so that when when modern communications technology is used by terrorists again, which it will happen, unfortunately, again, because as I said earlier, that's one of the realities of life, that good people and bad people use technology, that we can react faster, more ruthlessly, that we can identify that content more quickly. And so, of course, I understand, as any human being who was as upset and as anguished as anyone else by the horrific acts in Christchurch, of course I understand that people say, can't you just get rid of the problem by getting rid of live streaming? But, you know, the brutal truth is that technologies can't be uninvented. Live streaming is used for very, very positive reasons.
There was a video recently on Nancy Pelosi, which was manipulated. Yep. Facebook didn't want to take it offline.
No.
There was a deepfake video of Mark Zuckerberg made on Instagram, placed on Instagram. Critics fear that these cheap fakes and deep fakes are the next, let's say, harmful sort of disinformation on the web. Why not take them down?
The job for Facebook is to distinguish between satire, between something which is obviously manipulated or more subtly manipulated, and the deepest of deep fakes, where it is almost impossible to tell the difference between reality and artifice. Now, the approach we took to the Nancy Pelosi video is the approach that we take to most misinformation online, which is that we get a fact checker to fact it, to check it. When it's established that it's a manipulated or false piece of content, we then massively downgrade it, so it's much harder to find on your newsfeed. And crucially, if you've shared it, or you've tried to share it, you'll get something which will pop up on your screen saying, this has been checked as false or certified as false. Here are some associated articles to prove the point. We need to reduce the virality of content, because in a sense, the thing that social media introduces, which is new, is not only people's ability to express their voice, but also virality. So we need to be able to intervene more quickly. And then, and we're looking at this at the moment, could we be more aggressive at saying to people, not here are a few associated articles, but this is false. We are also looking at whether the highest risk deep fakes, which are quite different to just what you call the cheap fake of just slowing something down, whether we should treat those, including possibly removing them, altogether.
For all this, you need tens of thousands of moderators, content moderators. You're increasing the content moderators all the time, the amount of content moderators. It just seems unmanageable for all these content moderators to, control, to check every post online.
You're right. Of course, we could employ the size of the Chinese army of content moderators, and that would never be enough. Crucially, we have ever more sophisticated systems of machine learning and artificial intelligence, which can work at a much bigger scale to identify patterns. So, for instance, over 99% of Daesh and ISIS-related terrorist content is now removed by Facebook because of our artificial intelligence tools before anyone reports it.
We'll get back to politics, but first privacy. Since you have been at Facebook, privacy issues kept on breaking the news. We've had millions of user passwords which could be seen by thousands of Facebook employees this April. Last year there was the Onovo VPN app, which basically spied on users, was banned from the App Store. It seems like Facebook is not learning from its mistakes.
In theory, that could have been used by someone for malign purposes. Yes, errors do occur. They always do occur. And I'm not going to pretend to you they will not occur again. And yes, you are right to say we have a very heavy obligation to constantly do better and to learn from those mistakes.
A clear history button was promised last year. Within a few months, it's still not there. When will this be launched?
Look, I'm not going to give you a date, because I think the last time people were given a date, quite rightly, you say, well, hang on a minute, you haven't respected that. I don't want to raise expectations again. We have said that we are trying to work towards doing something in the late summer or early autumn of this year.
Soon, Facebook will launch Libra, yep. a cryptocurrency. Can you imagine that people with the track record Facebook has on privacy are very skeptical yeah. By expanding in such a way?
Of course I understand when people say, oh, you know, I've got doubts about whether Facebook, you know, keeps my data safe, so why should I trust them with my money? Which is why it's not a Facebook cryptocurrency. We will not run it. I both understand, anticipate why people should be concerned that, you know, too much power and authority falls into the hands of one company, which is exactly why we're doing something quite unusual, which is we are major players in developing this idea, but we're actively saying that we will not, cannot, must not be in charge of it.
Nevertheless, Facebook is expanding. Co-founder Chris Hughes earlier advocated split up of yep. Facebook, breaking up Facebook in an op-ed in the New York Times. Why isn't that a good idea?
Let's say if you, which I think is his suggestion, you split off WhatsApp from Facebook and Instagram. That does not solve any problems about privacy, about plain text passwords, about Russian interference in elections, about hateful speech, about content model. None of those problems go. And that's why our view is that breaking it up, whilst that appeals to a perfectly understandable sentiment of something must be done, it isn't actually the pragmatic solution.
Well, actually, the best solution would be to change the whole business model of Facebook, many critics are saying.
Yeah, I don't, unsurprisingly, I don't agree with that, because you see, one of the things that is, I think, often forgotten about the Facebook business model. So Facebook makes its money from advertisements, right? It means that the market holder, stall holder in Bangladesh, the student in Guatemala, the sheep shearer in Australia has just as much right and ability to use these extraordinary communication tools for free as a very wealthy lawyer or banker in Amsterdam or The Hague. Now, that is a remarkable thing about the Facebook business model.
Why not change it into a prepaid model like Netflix?
Let me explain why. Facebook could do that, but it would remove at a stroke one of the most remarkable things about these communication tools is that they are available to everybody for free. You don't need to pay for their use.
A commercial platform which has to channel free speech for billions of people in the world, isn't that alarming to you?
I think it is wrong, and I think if I understand your question, you are right to suggest this. It is wrong for private companies on their own to make judgments which are profoundly ethical or political in nature, and that's why we're very open. It just doesn't make sense for a private company to be the sole adjudicator of this dividing line between freedom of expression and unacceptable content. Because one person's hate speech is another person's freedom of expression. And that's not something that Mark Zuckerberg should do. It's not something that Facebook should do. That's what, particularly in the democratic world, democratically elected politicians should do. But that's all part of a journey in making sure that the power, the authority, the success that Facebook enjoys is held properly to account in the future.